investigation.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ambassador, thank you for being here. Thank you for your service to our country. Ambassador, should ambassadors ever try to influence host country elections?
No.
I think you said in your opening statement, partisanship of this type is not compatible with the role of a career foreign service officer. Is that right?
Yeah.
But that's exactly what happened in 2016. In August of 2016, the very month you went to Ukraine as our ambassador, the Ukrainian ambassador here in the United States, Ambassador Chali, wrote an op-ed in The Hill, said this, Trump's comments send wrong message. So the very month you're over there as our ambassador to Ukraine, Ambassador Chali writes that op-ed, and it wasn't just that attack, as Mr. Castor got into earlier, it wasn't just that attack on the president. We had former Ukrainian Prime Minister Yatsenyak, who criticized candidate Trump. We had Mr. Avakov. I believe earlier you said, Ambassador, that Mr. Avakov was the individual who first alerted you to the efforts of Mr. Giuliani. Mr. Avakov, back during this same time period in the months just prior to the 2016 election, called then-candidate Trump all kinds of names, called him a terrorist. And of course, we have Mr. Lushenko, a member of parliament, who was a source for Fusion GPS and now somewhat famous dossier that flowed from Fusion's work. He said this in the Financial Times, again, in August of 2016, when you first arrived in Ukraine, he said this, the majority of Ukrainian politicians are on Hillary Clinton's side. So you had several high-ranking officials in the government, in the Ukrainian government, and President Poroshenko is president of Ukraine, criticize President Trump, then candidate Trump, all in the late summer and fall of 2016. What I want to know, Ambassador, when this was all happening, did you go talk to anyone in the Ukrainian government about this? Did you go say to some of these officials, hey, you guys need to knock this off, this perception that we got, as Mr. Lushenko said, the majority of Ukrainian politicians on Hillary Clinton's side, that's not good. Did you have that conversation?
No.
Didn't talk to anyone in the government? Did you talk to President Poroshenko?
No.
Didn't alert anyone in the government?
No.
Well, one of the things we've heard so much over the last 6 weeks in depositions, and frankly in the hearing on Wednesday, is how important bipartisan support is for Ukraine. Democrats and Republicans agree they want to help Ukraine. In fact, the Democrats' first witness, their star witness on Wednesday, Mr. Taylor said Ukraine's most important strategic asset is this bipartisan support, and you would agree with that, right?
I do.
He said this in his testimony on Wednesday. On September 11th, I learned that the hold had been lifted the next day. Ambassador Taylor said, I conveyed this news to President Zelensky and the Ukrainian foreign minister, and I reminded Mr. Yarmak of the high strategic value of bipartisan support for Ukraine and the importance of not getting involved in other countries' elections. So what I'm wondering is, this is the day after the aid's been lifted that Ambassador Taylor made this statement to the Ukrainian government. And he makes this after there's nothing been done by Ukraine to influence our election, because President Zelensky didn't announce he was doing an investigation and the aid was lifted. But he felt he needed to say that. But in 2016, when we know that the majority of Ukrainian politicians want Clinton to win, because it was said by a member of parliament, when the ambassador to the United States from Ukraine writes an op-ed criticizing then-candidate Trump, when Mr. Avakov calls candidate Trump all kinds of names, nobody goes and talks to him and tells him to knock it off. Did you have any conversations, Ambassador, with Victoria Nuland or Secretary of State Perry about what was going on in 2016 and this majority of Ukrainian politicians being for candidate Clinton and not and opposed to President Trump?
No, I did not.
No one did anything. No one did anything. Do you see why maybe the president was a little concerned about what went on in Ukraine? And you couple that with the corruption level that we know exists in Ukraine, you add to that this idea that he's not a big fan of foreign aid, why he might be a little concerned about sending the hard-earned tax dollars of the American people to Ukraine?
I'm sorry, is there a question there?
There was.
Okay. Could you repeat it, please?
I'm asking...
Time of the gentleman's expired, but I'll allow you to repeat the question.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm asking, maybe we can kind of see why the president was a little concerned when you have the highest-ranking officials in the government, the ambassador criticizing him, parliamentary member Lashenko criticizing him, when you have Avakov, the guy who first told you about Giuliani, criticizing him. All this going on, and when you couple that with the concerns he has about corruption, the concerns he has about Europe not doing enough, the concerns he has about reluctance to send in the hard-earned tax dollars to any country,
Jordan,
frankly.
I have indulged you with extra time, but
I appreciate it.
My indulgence is wearing out.
I appreciate it.
There is a question, right?
Our indulgence wore out with you a long time ago, Mr. Chairman.
I'll tell you that.
But
I'm about to gavel you down, so if you have a question, I suggest you
I'm asking her, do you think there's maybe a reason that this was, that President Trump's concern was justified?
You know, I can't speak for the president on this, but what I would say is, you've listed a number of actions. I think from my point of view, that doesn't create a Ukrainian government strategy to interfere in our election.
I didn't say that.
Mr. Jordan, please allow the ambassador to answer the question.
So I would just say that, you know, U.S. politicians will often criticize policies of foreign counterparts, even perhaps during their elections. You know, this happens in politics, and I think that it doesn't necessarily constitute interference.
Would you ever write an op-ed,
Jordan, your time
critical
expired.
Of a presidential
Jordan,
candidate in Ukraine?
Jordan, your time has expired. Mr. Welch, you're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Like everybody here, I'm extraordinarily grateful to you for your career at public service, and I feel very badly about what you've had to endure. Like your colleagues, you don't complain. You're doing your job. I feel badly about the insults, the tweet this morning, the fact that you were smeared, not fired. But the question, as you know, is not how you were treated. Mm-hmm. The question is why the president did what he did and whether what he did was a breach of trust. The question really is about whether the president of the United States, any president, has the authority to withhold congressionally approved aid, to condition a White House meeting on extracting from a foreign leader a willingness to assist him in his political campaign? That's the question. And that brings us to you as part of the story, because the question is, why were you fired from that position? I want to read a portion of the president's call on July 25th with President Zelensky. And this is the painful part when you first heard about it. The former ambassador from the United States, the woman, was bad news, and the people she was dealing with in Ukraine were bad news. So I just want to let you know that. The other thing, he goes right into this, there's a lot of talk about Biden's son, that Biden stopped the prosecution. And a lot of the people want to find out about that, so whatever you can do with the Attorney General would be great. You indicated in response to my colleague Mr. Castro's question that if you were asked to approach a foreign leader and condition American support on their being involved in our campaign, you would refuse to do that.
Yes. Yes.
And you're aware now, but I don't know if you were then, but that July 25th phone call occurred the day after Director Mueller reported that the interference in our 2016 campaign was not from Ukraine. It was active, concerted, energetic, and by the Russians, correct?
Yes.
All right. Now, as ambassador, you had no knowledge of whatever it is President Trump ultimately seems to have wanted to get for cooperation in this investigation. Isn't that, that's correct?
Yes.
All right. Now, you've been asked about whether a president has authority to replace an ambassador, and you have agreed that that's the president's prerogative.
Yes, that's true.
But that assumes that the reasons are not related to the personal, private, political interest of the president at the expense of our national security, right?
Yes.
And you've been the target of insults from the president. You join some very distinguished company, by the way, Senator McCain, General Kelly, man I admire, I think all of us do, General Mattis. We're not here to talk about that, unless the reason you get insulted is you did today, essentially blaming you for Somalia, is if this is another step by the president to intimidate witnesses. He didn't intimidate you. You're here. You've endured. But there are other people out there that can expect the Trump treatment if they come forward. That's a question for us. Now, you also indicated that the president has a prerogative to appoint a non-career person. And to be candid, Republican presidents and Democratic presidents have done that. The Mr. Sondland's transcript is out, and he was someone who indicated that everything hinged this the White House meeting and the release of the vital defensive aid, everything hinged on the President Zelensky being willing to do that investigation that would benefit the Trump campaign. You're aware of that?
Yes.
And you've indicated that's something that you would not agree to do?
Yes.
And Sondland was quite willing to do?
Apparently so.
I thank you for your professional service, and I yield back.
Thank you.
Mr. Maloney.
Ambassador Yovanovitch, thank you for being here. It's been a long day. You know, the first time we met, it wasn't clear, and so I just want to start with a quick comment. But, you know, your testimony in this inquiry broke the dam. You were the first one through that stone wall that the president was trying to set up. And I just want to thank you for that, because others have followed your example. And there's an old expression that first person through the wall gets a little bit bloody, and I think you must understand that expression in a new way. Mm-hmm. But thank you.
Thank you.
I want to ask you about the day you were let go. Mm-hmm. And I know this is a painful series of events, so forgive me, but I think it's very important. It's April 24th, and you told us a few things that really stuck with me. You said you were at the embassy in Ukraine, you were honoring a Ukrainian woman, an anti-corruption activist. I believe her name is Katerina Handzyuk. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Am I saying that correctly?
Mm-hmm. I was at my house.
You were at your house, excuse me. Mm-hmm. And you were giving her the Woman of Courage Award, I believe.
Yeah, the Embassy Kyiv's Woman of Courage Award.
Right. And, of course, that's the day you get a call from Carol Perez, mm-hmm. A senior member of the Foreign Service. Did you know Carol Perez?
Yes.
You're both senior women in the Foreign Service. You had an opportunity to meet her before?
Yes.
And she says, there's trouble coming. I want to give you a heads up. Correct me if I get this wrong, and I don't know a lot, but it's coming from the White House. I'll call you later.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that sums it up.
But you're literally that evening honoring this anti-corruption activist. Is that right?
Yes.
And not just any woman, but a woman who was, you said, horribly attacked and killed for her efforts. And she wasn't just killed. You said I believe that someone threw acid on her.
That's correct.
And I went and I checked during the break, and it turns out she was horribly injured, and it took 4 months for her to die. Is that right?
A very painful death.
Why would somebody attack her with acid? There are easier ways to kill people. Why do you think they did it with acid?
Well, I think they wanted her out of the way, but I think the message was, this could happen to you, too, if you continue her work.
That's what happens when you go up against corrupt people in Ukraine.
It is something that can happen. I mean, there are other ways of sidelining people.
Do you remember speaking at that event?
I do.
I went and looked at what you said. You said, Katerina paid the ultimate price for her fearlessness in fighting against corruption and for her determined efforts to build a democratic Ukraine. Do you remember saying that?
Yes.
And then your phone rings, and you hear this trouble up the street. And Carol Perez called you back later that night, right?
Mm-hmm.
It was 1 a.m., I believe.
Yes.
Were you sleeping?
No.
You had stayed up?
Yes.
To get the phone call?
Yes.
And that's when she says two things, I believe, that really stuck with me. She said, we're worried about your security.
Yes.
You've just been honoring a woman who was killed for fighting for her anti-corruption efforts. And she says, you got to get on the next plane. Was she speaking euphemistically, get on the next plane, you know, when you get time? Did she mean literally the next plane?
Well, I think she meant, you know, as soon as possible. But pretty much it was the next plane.
And that's a pretty good flight back from Kyiv to Washington, and you're on your way to meet with Deputy Secretary Sullivan.
Yes.
And he says to you two things. He says there was a concerted effort against you, and he says you've done nothing wrong.
Right.
And when he said, what I'm fascinated about is when he says you've done nothing wrong, what did you expect the United States government would do next?
You know, it was pretty clear that a decision had been made by the president, implemented by the State Department, that I had to leave Ukraine. But I had hoped that there would be more public support.
Did you expect them to have your back?
Yes.
And were you surprised when you found out they weren't gonna?
Not at that point anymore.
Why?
Well, because over the last several months, that had not been the case.
Ma'am, in your opening statement, you said, how could our system fail like this?
Yeah.
How is it that foreign corrupt interests could manipulate our government? How could our system fail like this? How is it that foreign corrupt interests could manipulate our government? I want you to know, ma'am, that that is the very question we are determined to get an answer for. And I want to thank you on behalf of your country for your service and with our work in answering that question. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Ms. Demings.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman. Ambassador, everyone in this room should be thankful for your service to our nation. I have four little girls in my life, and as I sit here thinking about them and as a woman, I cannot be prouder of you, and I consider you an inspiration for women around the world. I just have to say before I get into my questioning is I think it's disgraceful to hear my colleagues refer to your sworn testimony as a performance today or speak in a condescending way, basically suggesting that the woman, because I think that's how the president referred to you, I'm not sure he knows your name or there's some other meaning there, but to basically suggest that the woman should be thankful for whatever she was left with, smear campaign and all, after you were recalled. But I want you to know today that we thank you for your service, your 33 years of service. Ambassador, on a press conference call on October 17th, Acting White House Chief of Staff Mulvaney discussed his belief that it's entirely appropriate to politicize U.S. foreign policy. Here's what he said. If you read the news reports and you believe them, what did McKinley say yesterday? Well, McKinley said yesterday that he was really upset with the political influence in foreign policy. That was one of the reasons he was so upset about this. And I have news for everybody. Get over it. There's going to be political influence in foreign policy. Ambassador Yovanovitch, do you share the concern raised by Ambassador McKinley in testimony before this committee about political influence in foreign policy?
Well, as I said before, I think it's important to keep political influence out of foreign policy because we all, whether we are Republican or Democrats or something else, have common security interests, and that needs to be safeguarded and advanced.
And what message do you think it sends to other foreign service officers and public servants, which we so desperately need good ones, when an administration refuses to support its own officials in the face of a smear campaign?
Well, it's deeply troubling. It's deeply troubling, and there are morale issues at the State Department.
Morale issues at the State Department. I can understand why. On March 20th of 2019, President Trump tweeted an article that included a letter from Representative Pete Sessions that said you had, and I quote, spoken privately and repeatedly about your disdain for the current administration in a way that might call for the expulsion of you as U.S. ambassador to Ukraine immediately. Did you speak publicly and privately about your disdain for the Trump administration?
No.
Why do you think the president would want to push such a lie?
I don't know.
Policies change, but U.S. interests don't. Not for those who are seeking to do the work of protecting our nation, the work you have done for decades. The president, his chief of staff, and his allies seem to want nothing more than to smear the good people trying to protect this country and to hijack our institutions for their personal and political gain. Again, Ambassador, we thank you so much for your service, and I'll yield my remaining time to the chairman.
Thank you.
I thank the gentlewoman. I'm going to go to Mr. Krishnamurthy.
Good afternoon, Ambassador, and thank you to the family as well for being here in support of you today. I'd like to direct you to an area of bipartisanship, namely aid to Ukraine. Mm-hmm. Congress, on an overwhelmingly bipartisan basis, has appropriated hundreds of millions of dollars in military assistance to Ukraine, correct?
Yes.
And that aid is being used by Ukraine to fight a common adversary, namely Russia, right?
Yes.
The U.S., in fact, has consistently partnered with other European countries to keep Russia at bay and maintain the peace in Europe, right?
Yes.
As Ambassador Taylor suggested earlier this week, supporting Ukraine helps maintain peace so that Americans don't have to go to war again in Europe, right?
Yes.
Suspending that aid and weakening Ukraine can increase the likelihood of the opposite, correct?
Yes, it is extremely short-sighted.
The last time you were in Ukraine was May 20th of this year, right?
Yes.
In his opening statement, Ambassador Taylor said he took charge in Ukraine on June 17th.
Yes.
Therefore, there was almost a one-month gap between the time you departed and when Taylor took over, right?
Yes, yes.
During that time, on May 20th, Ambassador Sondland, Rick Perry, and others came to the inauguration of President Zelensky, right?
Yes.
And during that gap in time, Ambassador Sondland visited the White House, along with others, and got directions from President Trump to talk to Rudy. Those were his words. Talk to Rudy about what to do in Ukraine, right?
That's my understanding.
In other words, isn't it the case that your departure and the one-month gap between the time you left and when Ambassador Taylor arrived provided the perfect opportunity for another group of people to basically take over Ukraine policy. Isn't that right?
Yeah.
Ambassador, you're going to have to speak a little louder into the mic.
Yes, yes.
Thank you. On page 10 of your opening statement, you mentioned, quote, unquote, corrupt interests apparently hijacking our Ukraine policy, right?
Yes.
A couple of suspect individuals in that regard were Lev Parnas and Igor Fruman, right?
Yes.
You mentioned in response to minority counsel earlier that you learned that Fruman and Parnas were attempting to open a liquefied natural gas company, correct?
Yes.
How did you learn that, by the way?
I heard it from the Minister of Interior.
Interestingly, at noon today, The Wall Street Journal reported that federal prosecutors in Manhattan are investigating whether Rudy Giuliani stood to personally profit from that liquefied natural gas venture. Do you have any knowledge of that?
No, I do not.
Maybe we should talk to Rudy, huh? Ambassador, I'd like to direct you to another line of questioning that I had for Ambassador Taylor earlier this week. He said that there were irregular channels of diplomacy at work in Ukraine, circumventing normal diplomatic channels and threatening American interests in favor of private interests. I asked him the question, can you rule out the possibility that these irregular channels of diplomacy are being used in other countries where we conduct foreign policy? In response, he said that he could not rule it out. Ambassador Yovanovitch, I ask you, and I assume that you can't rule it out either, correct?
I can't, but I would also add I have no knowledge of that.
I understand. Are you concerned that these irregular channels of diplomacy may be at work elsewhere?
I think it's a possibility.
You testified that it was a, quote unquote, dangerous precedent that private interests and people who don't like a particular ambassador could combine to replace that ambassador. Are you concerned that other ambassadors may suffer the same fate as you?
Yes.
Ambassador, in your service as an American diplomat, you have encountered various dictators and strong men ruling other countries, right?
Yes.
In your personal life, your parents fled the Soviet Union and Nazi Germany, and they became familiar with despots and dictators as well, correct?
Yes.
Indeed, you're an authority on authoritarianism, right?
Well, maybe.
Is it a feature of authoritarianism to allow corrupt interests to hijack foreign policy?
Yeah.
Is it a feature of authoritarianism for the rulers there to claim absolute rights?
Yes.
And is it a hallmark of authoritarianism for those rulers to smear their opponents?
Sometimes, yes.
Thank you.
Time of the gentleman has expired. Mr. Nunes, do you have any concluding remarks?
I would just say to the American people, today's show trial has come to an end. We're headed down now to the basement of the Capitol to go until I don't know what time, and we'll be back there hiding again behind the closed doors, interviewing more witnesses that you may or may not be able to see in the public. I hate to break it to my colleagues if there's anyone else out there watching television ratings, but they must be plummeting right now. And I would suggest that we get back to the work of the Intelligence Committee, that we pass a trade agreement with the United States, Mexico, and Canada that would actually help the American people out, because this is an embarrassment. I'll yield back.
Mr. Chairman, may I be recognized for a motion?
No, I have some concluding remarks. Ambassador, I want to thank you for your decades of service. I want to thank you, as Mr. Maloney said, for being the first one through the gap. What you did in coming forward in answering a lawful subpoena was to give courage to others that also witnessed wrongdoing, that they, too, could show the same courage that you have, that they could stand up, speak out, answer questions. They could endure whatever threats, insults may come their way. And so, in your long and distinguished career, you have done another great public service in answering the call of our subpoena and testifying before us today. I think you gathered from our comments that we not only grieve for what you went through, but what damage is being done to the State Department, to career federal foreign service officers all over the country. I am profoundly grateful to you and Mr. Kent and Ambassador Taylor, who have done so much in the last 2 days or 3 days to show the American people the face of our diplomatic corps, the extraordinary public servants who work all around the world in very dangerous places, as you have. And so I'm glad they've gotten to see you because you're often vilified as bureaucrats or diplomacy is diminished as unimportant. Anything other than the military doesn't really matter when it's your efforts that often prevent us from going to war. Sometimes you're disparaged as the deep state. But what you are is what holds this country together, what holds our foreign policy together, what makes it seamless, what makes it work. And I'm glad America gets to see that. I will just emphasize once again about the importance of your testimony. Mr. Kent and Ambassador Taylor gave us the broad outlines of this story. This is a story about an effort to coerce, condition, or bribe a foreign country into doing the dirty work of the president, investigations of his political rival, by conditioning U.S. taxpayer money, by conditioning a meeting that President Zelensky desperately wanted and needed to establish that relationship with the most powerful patron of Ukraine, the United States of America. The fact that they failed in this solicitation of bribery doesn't make it any less bribery, doesn't make it any less immoral or corrupt. It just means it was unsuccessful. And to that, we owe other dedicated public servants who blew the whistle. Had they not blown the whistle, we wouldn't be here. And I think it is appalling that my colleagues continue to want to out this whistleblower so that he or she can be punished by this president. But let's underscore once again, while you are the beginning of this story, you're not the end of it, but nonetheless, the beginning is important. Because the beginning of the story is an effort to get you out of the way, an effort by Rudy Giuliani and Fruman and Parnas and corrupt Ukrainians like Lutsenko to get you out of the way. Because they felt you were an impediment to these political investigations the president so desperately wanted. Giuliani has made it abundantly clear he was in Ukraine on a mission for his client, for the president, to investigate the Bidens. And you were viewed as an obstacle that had to go, not just by Giuliani, but by the President of the United States. And if people had any doubt about it, they should do what the President asks, read the transcript. And what they'll see in that transcript is the President praises the corrupt. He praises the corrupt, Lutsenko. He condemns the just, you. And then he asks for an investigation of the Bidens. There is no camouflaging that corrupt intent. We are adjourned.
Mr. Speaker, I'll speak on a condition.
Mr. Chairman, you disparaged
those members on this side of the aisle. We should have a chance to respond to your disparaging remarks. Mr. Chairman, I demand or speak. Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman.